Okay, in this video, I want to cover a little bit about what this course is about and why you should be excited to take it, as well as some of the assumed background and what we sort of expect from people before they get to the class. So, as I mentioned in the previous video, this class is really about the essential concepts that are going to be relevant in any programming language and how programming languages combine those concepts and the pieces fit together to create something that lets us build the software we want to build. So we're going to use three languages, ML, Racket, and Ruby. And the reason why we're going to use those is that they complement each other in different ways. They are functional languages, Ruby is an object-oriented language, and they let the concepts that I want to focus on really shine. That doesn't mean they're the best languages out there. It doesn't mean that these concepts aren't also in other languages. But by using a few languages that probably most of you are not familiar with, we'll be able to see some of the same concepts come up over and over again in ways that look slightly different, or maybe in terms of how they work actually are slightly different. And that'll let us reinforce the ideas and do so in a setting that in many ways is simpler than some industrial strength languages like Java or C# or Python. Which again doesn't mean that one language is better than the other. That's not my claim. I'm not going to make any claims about that. But certain concepts are just sort of more natural and more focused on and are the key building blocks in some languages, and then different concepts, slightly different ones, in other languages. As you'll see, especially in the first half to two-thirds of the course, we're going to focus a lot on functional programming, and we'll learn in great detail what that really means. But just at a high level to get us started, it means we're not going to use what I call mutation. Which you may know of as assignment statements. We're not going to update the contents of an array or a variable or a field of an object. We're just going to let variables represent values and not change what those variables represent. The other thing we're going to do that's the sort of the other part of functional programming is use functions that are a little bit like methods as data themselves. They're going to be first class. And frankly, until we get there in the course, it's a little too hard to explain exactly what I mean by that. Now, in case you already know functional programming or whatnot, that's not the only thing we're going to cover. We're going to cover lots of other things like modularity, the difference between static and dynamic typing, and a whole bunch more. Where is this course situated in terms of how much I already think you know? This is not an introductory programming course. There are many great introductory programming courses, including those that start with functional programming. But I am going to assume that you have done some programming before, roughly one or two courses worth or a little bit of on-the-job experience or whatnot. But conversely, this is also not an advanced course on programming languages. I'm not going to assume that you already have been a full-time software developer or a full-time professional or already have, say, 3 years of computer science training. So it really is somewhere in the middle, and let me try to give a little bit more of a sense of that. I assume that you already have seen things like variables that hold data in them, if statements or some form of conditional, that you've probably programmed with something like a while loop or a for loop, that you've seen arrays, and perhaps something that some of you find a little more difficult, I do assume that you've seen recursion before, so methods or functions or objects that are implemented in terms of themselves. If you're not super confident with recursion, you'll get tons of practice on the first homework assignment. Almost every problem requires recursion, but I'm not going to teach recursion from scratch. I also assume that you're familiar with the difference between an implementation, how something is actually done, from its interface, how users of it, how clients of it can think about it and what they need to know. You may have done that with object-oriented programming. That's what a lot of people do early on when they're learning to program. And I won't necessarily assume that, but that's probably the most common way that you saw things like implementation versus interface. Basic linked structures like linked lists or binary trees. And you've probably seen in object-oriented programming before the idea of creating a subclass or overriding a method or something like that. If not, it's probably okay because we're not going to study that topic until fairly late in the course, and then we'll briefly review it. So what I thought I would do, also to give you a sense of what we'll often do in the class, is I'll just show you a little bit of code in Java along the lines of what I think you mostly already know or could learn quickly again with a brief refresher. So if you have never seen Java before, maybe some of this syntax, how it's written down, will look strange to you. But the ideas hopefully do not. So what I'm defining here is a simple binary tree where every node in the tree holds an integer. So we have a structure where everything that isn't null, that isn't a leaf with nothing in it, has an integer, and then two children that are also these things holding integers. And if I want to create one of these in an object-oriented programming like Java, I typically have a constructor. This is just a method that's going to take some arguments and make a new one of these. And I'm just going to do it by initializing the three fields to the arguments to this method. And again, if there's some small thing I'm doing that looks unfamiliar, that might be okay because we're not going to use Java in this course. But if the things I'm saying make absolutely no sense at all, then an introductory programming course might be a better match for you. So now what I'm doing is just writing a method that's going to take one of these trees and sum up all the integers in the whole thing. And for a tree like this, even in Java, you're best off using recursion. So here I'm writing a sumAll method. And what I'm doing is implementing it in terms of using that same code, sumAll, on the left child and the right child. And in an object-oriented programming language, that's going to look like left.sumAll and right.sumAll. We'll see starting in just a few videos that in ML our recursion will look a little different, but the logic of the algorithm will be similar. So hopefully there aren't too many typos here. If there are, I'll clean them up before I post the code on the website. And this is just a little bit of Java code. Let me show one other thing, which in the interest of expediency, I'll just paste over here. And this is another method. Whoop, not what I wanted. Try that again. You'll get used to me making little errors as I write code for you on the fly. Here's a little method that takes an array and returns the maximum element in the array. And it's worth pointing out that this code assumes the array has at least one element. Otherwise, you would get an exception. And what it does is it initializes this answer variable to hold the contents of the first array element. Then it has a little for loop updating that array element, updating ants to be a larger value if it finds a larger value, and then it returns it. This is the sort of programming in some language I assume you've done before, even though the programming we're going to do over the next week or two is going to look very, very different. And we're never going to have these assignment statements like ants equal array sub I, because the core idea of functional programming is that we don't update variables to have different values than they had before. Okay, so that gives you a sense of how I'll write code for you in class, although that's the last Java we'll see for quite a while. Now let me flip back to the slides and tell you a little bit more. So I will occasionally compare to Java in the videos. That'll always be optional. In fact, usually in separate videos. If you know C#, you'll be able to follow those along just fine. Occasionally, I'll compare to C, and those videos will definitely be optional. If all the programming you've done before has been in Python or JavaScript, that'll be just fine. The thing you'll probably find strangest about ML, the language we use for the first few weeks, is the type system that a lot of programs are rejected before you start running them. But none of this is going to be our focus moving forward in the next few videos. That I really want us to focus on starting over from scratch. That as much as I kind of assume you've programmed before so that I can move quickly, imagine you haven't. That just let's learn a new language as though it's nothing like we've ever seen before. So why do this? Well, normally what I would do, what most courses would do, is at this point they would motivate why you would learn this sort of material. I'm actually mostly going to ask for your patience here. In my experience, we don't have quite enough shared vocabulary to do that yet. So if we wait a couple weeks, and then I motivate functional programming and some of the specific concepts we're going to study in the course, it'll make a lot more sense. It'll be a much more effective use of your time and mine. And I promise that everything we'll do will be suitably motivated, and I'll give you the reasons for learning to program in this style. The one claim I'll make today is that learning to think about software the way we're going to start doing is going to feel really strange for the first week or two. And I truly believe that it will make you a better programmer, even if after this course you mostly go back to programming in the way you learned previously. That enough will stay with you and it'll influence enough of your design decisions that it will make you a better programmer no matter what you do, and it will prepare you for a lifetime of picking up new languages, new concepts, and understanding how program languages fit together. And probably one of my favorite analogies is this movie that I actually think is not my favorite movie for whatever reason, but it's The Karate Kid. And if you haven't seen it, the basic idea is that this kid wants to learn karate, and the karate master spends days making the kid do repetitive tasks that apparently have nothing to do with karate, like washing windows or picking up clothes or whatever. But in fact, he's learning muscle skills that are exactly the skills you need to block kicks and kick people and things like that. And that's the idea behind the movie. And I think that's the kind of programming we're going to do for the next couple weeks. It will feel different. It will feel uncomfortable. It will not feel like programming you've done before. And then voila, the light bulb will go off, and you'll realize that this is actually making you better at writing software. We're going to use a strange environment for the next few weeks. We're going to use this ML language. We're going to use the Emacs editor, which is in fact the editor in which I just wrote that Java code. And to run programs, we're going to use this thing called the read-eval print loop, or the REPL, which I'm going to show you in the upcoming videos. And so you need to get this all installed and configured. We've provided videos and written instructions to help you. And all I can sort of say about this is learning new tools and working in environments you're not familiar with is something you do all the time as a computer scientist or a software developer, and this class is no different. Okay, so in subsequent lectures, we're going to do a lot more writing code in ML, a lot less focus on the slides. In fact, we'll just switch back to the slides for the key concepts. We'll also start having videos that pause in the middle and ask you questions to make sure you're understanding the ideas. And I hope you'll find them more exciting than these sort of introduction videos where I just need to set the stage and get us started.